Mercedes-AMG Interview Lounge.
And we welcome Soleil Moon Frye. Hi, Soleil Moon Frye. Welcome to the show.
I am so excited to be here.
Well, it's good to have you. It's good to be able to talk about these projects that you have going on now. Soleil Moon Frye, of course, you could go all the way back to Punky Brewster, but you've been working. I mean, it is unusual, is it not, for someone who was a big thing while they're a child working in Hollywood to still be working in Hollywood. Most of them sort of disappear. You've been working
nonstop. I feel so grateful. I feel like there's a whole bunch of us, though, that are still working and doing what we love and flourishing and growing. And I love that I get to see so many of them so often. And so it's really fun.
Well, we really want to talk about the documentary in a second. That is the most fascinating project. We'll get to that. Also, I want to talk about the reboot, Punky Brewster on Peacock.
Yay!
Talk about it. When you got the call, and they said, well, we want you to be on, but it's a whole new world now in the storyline. How did you feel about it?
Well, really, I was part of the whole birthing process of the continuation, as I like to call it, because it feels so much like a continuation versus a reboot, you know? And I love Punky so much, and I've always wanted to bring Punky back. Like, that's always been such a part of my heart and soul. And I've always said, you know, if I'm 80, 90, 100 years old and people still call me Punky, I'll be so down with it because I hold her so close to my heart. I am like full on Punky power forever. Like, I love it. And I think that goes to the authenticity and the heart of the original. And so I've always held her really close to me. And so over the years, I really, really wanted to bring her back. And this incredible guy named Jimmy Fox that I worked with, he reached out and I was like, I've been wanting to do this for years. And then we started meeting people and we met the incredible Steve and Jim, and they are these phenomenal showrunners and our partners on it. And we just, it was such a natural process, and it was so wonderful to be involved in every step of it, you know what I mean? And that was everything from, you know, when we were, you know, in the script stages to, you know, the amazing working with the network and the studio, who were so incredibly supportive, and casting and costumes and the design, like, just to be a part of that was so special. And so it's been really a dream come true.
Well, I must assume when you were much younger in the original Punky Brewster, when you showed up for work, you did your thing and you left. Now you're in charge of a lot of responsibility. And you know, also, and one of the good things that's come out of this awful, awful year and a half with COVID and everything is the people are loving going back in time, going back to the time when they were
nostalgia,
kids.
Right? Of course.
Does that make you feel old when someone says, I get so nostalgic looking at you, Soleil?
I'm such a nostalgic person, and that's such a big part of my life. I mean, the kids and I, you know, watch John Hughes movies on a regular basis. We listen to music, you know, constantly from the 80s, from the 60s, from the 70s. I mean, we are a very nostalgic family, I would say. So I love it, and it's something that I can really identify with and connect to. And for me, I feel so much joy in being able to, you know, bring these elements of our childhood back. And you know, I constantly say, you know, especially through the experience of the documentary, it's almost like I feel like I am coming of age again, you know. And I think we continue to come of age as we expand in life and grow. And as long as we're expanding and growing, then we get to continue to rediscover ourselves. And I think that's one of the great joys of this incredible experience.
And I'm guessing, like, over the years, like, you probably stayed in contact with some people from the cast and the original cast. But, like, when you see people for the first time that you haven't seen in so long, like, how cool is that?
Okay, such a great question. And literally, it's so funny because Cherie and I had grown up our whole lives together. And then it's like something happened where nothing dramatic happened. We didn't realize that we hadn't seen each other in like literally 18 years or something, or 16 years, so wow. many years. And we've always had this amazing relationship where, you know, those friends that you just pick right back up with, and yeah. it's like not a moment had gone by. And I think we were just communicating telepathically all those years, because I'll never forget when we came back together, and it was we did our pilot pre-COVID, and then we shot the rest of the season throughout COVID, really safety over fear. Like, it was incredible to keep going. And when I got to see her though pre-COVID, and she came off the elevator, it was like I was waiting for her on the other side of the elevator, and every time the elevator doors would open, I would be like, oh, so excited. And then she came out, and I burst into tears, because wow. I love her so much, and we've always been much more like sisters than friends. You know what I mean? It was like, it's just always been one of those spirit, soulful relationships that is so authentic.
Oh, I love it. So when it comes to all of the things that you're doing now, you're writing for it, you have all kinds of hands-on behind the scenes.
We have incredible writers. I just got to, like, you know, share ideas. My personal stories and stuff.
There you go.
Do you have anything to do with casting or who's in it? And I'm asking because what you might not know is Elvis is now specializing in playing dead bodies, and I was hoping you could work that in to a Punky Brewster episode.
We would love to have you on, Elvis. And we would love to invite all of you guys. And yeah, it was incredible to be a part of that process, and very exciting and really fun. And also, it was beautiful because the people in which, you know, came together, it really felt like it felt authentically like how Punky's family would be at that. You know what I mean? Like, it just, we really, it's like, I just loved diving in and working with everyone so much. And it felt much more like a family than, you know, a work family.
I just don't see a dead body on Punky Brewster.
No.
Just...
See, this is a challenge. I think they're up to it. I think they can do it.
Well, by
the
way,
body.
You know, one of my favorite episodes is the CPR episode, you know, with Cherie, where she ends up in the refrigerator. And I think that's a very, you know, popular episode. So what if we brought you back to life? Well, yes. How do you feel about that?
I tell you what, rather than send
awesome.
You, rather than sending
the
you,
the question is, who does CPR on you? You
watch Law and Order SVU on the 28th because I played the dead body. It's been my dream my entire life, and now I'm finally on there. I'm so excited. By the way, if you're just listening to us, turning us on, you can listen to the full interview with Soleil Moon Frye later on demand. You missed a lot so far, and you can go back and listen to it on your own. Now, let's talk about your documentary, Kid 90. You know, you growing up in Hollywood, working on set and behind the scenes, making all these friends who are also doing the same thing, but in different productions, you had the advantage I didn't have as a kid, and that was being able to capture a lot of this with a camera that wasn't as large as a small car. I mean, you were actually recording things and capturing things with your friends that maybe at the time you had no clue would ever be worth anything or any. It's now worth gold because this documentary is taking you back. You're reliving your life, and you're probably surprised by a lot of the stuff you said and your friend said, and now we get to see it too. Of course, we're talking about Kid 90, this documentary that's just amazing. Talk about this and talk about how it's changed your life.
Oh, thank you so much. It's changed my life so much. It was as if my teen self really left this chronological blueprint for me to find my way back to who I once was, you know, and it's been such a gift. And in unlocking Pandora's box, you know, it was really this realization that once you unlock it, you can't put it back, nor would I want to, because there was so much self-discovery and self-love that was discovered throughout. And it's been such an amazing journey. It's brought me back together with so many of my lifelong friends and those beautiful connections. And then to be able to share it with the world, my dream was always that people would watch it through their own lens, and to see the outpouring of love from people that are watching it and sharing their own experiences with me, it has been totally awe-inspiring because they really are watching it through their own perspectives. And as an artist and as a human being, that is really a dream of mine, that we get to share our experiences with each other.
We're talking about lifelong friends like David Arquette and Balk Gaddy and Brian Austin Green. I mean, Mark Paul Gosselaar. I mean, it goes on and on. Did any of them originally come up to you and go, you know what? No, no. I don't want any footage of me. No.
I have to say everyone has been so supportive. And the outpouring of love and support from other people that were captured. I mean, you know, people like Michael Rappaport, who has been such an advocate right. for it. And, you know, so many other people and friends in the skate community and friends, you know, in Los Angeles. People have really rallied around it. And it's so beautiful. And the amazing Appian Way that have been such incredible partners. And Sean Penn, like just amazing, brilliant, beautiful artists who have all come together and been so supportive. And on the music side, the musicians, you know, Linda Perry creating this brilliant, beautiful score and putting her, you know, her heart and her love and her tears into it. And, you know, friends like, you know, Jill and Eddie Vedder and their music. I mean, just really incredible people. You know, I had like my dream manifestation and it's just like looking at it happening in front of me. And I just feel so grateful and humbled by it. And the fact that I get to share it with others is just the greatest joy.
Was there anything other than the fun times you saw and witnessed?
By the way, I didn't mean that in a name droppy way. I meant it in like,
I love it. That's okay.
I hope it didn't sound that way. What I was trying to just say
down
was,
there, I see a lot of names on the floor.
I mean, let me just pick that up. My point was that people that were artists that I respected most really came to rally around me. And as an artist, that was such an incredible feeling to have my friends rally around and then to have people I've never met before sharing their stories, who are teachers, who are doctors, who are nurses, who are on the front lines, who are sharing their personal experiences with me through social media. It makes me feel so connected to them. So that's been a real joy in my life.
Not name droppy at all. I think it's very interesting. But what about memories it unearthed that you totally, totally forgot about? I mean, that happens to any of us who, when we go back in time and we see pictures and video. What'd you get?
You know, it was fascinating because there was so much joy and love and bliss in these tapes. And I mean, and look, I really go there, you know, I show up. Like, I mean, we had our amazing innocence and then like I had some wild times and it's all there in the documentary because I felt like, you know, it didn't start out as this personal coming of age story. I tried to make it about everybody but me. And then as the onion peeled back further and further, I really like to thy own self needed to be true. And so following that heart and soul of the project is really, it was such an evolution. And in that also a lot of pain was unlocked and a lot of things that I had locked away and I think, you know, suppressed. And I think so often when we go through pain in our life or trauma or have these experiences, you know, we put them away and in some way we feel shame attached to it, or at least I can only speak to my personal experience. I think in some ways I felt like I had to lock that away and I just never looked back at it. And it was probably very much on a subconscious level, you know, that I locked all these tapes away and put them in Tupperware and put them away because then I didn't have to face it. And once I unlocked it, it was this rediscovery. And at the same time, my family always raised us that when you turn your pain into art, then you have a place to put it. And so that's really what this became for me was a
wow.
Canoe.
Wow. If we could all do that, how incredible, right? Yeah, Scotty yep. B.
So I was also in high school the same time you were. And I was that guy that had the video camera everywhere, every day. And I have bins and bins of hundreds of VHS-C tapes. And it's very intimidating. How long did it take you to go through everything and figure out what you wanted to do with it?
So literally, it's been a lifetime in the making. It took me the last 4.5 years to really go through all of the footage, all of the audios, the diaries, because there's thousands and thousands of pages of diaries. There's hundreds upon hundreds of hours of audio and hundreds of hours of video. And so just from the digitizing to then, and literally just going through it for years and living with it, it's been quite the process and really needing to be there for every moment of it, you know, because I had, it was so fascinating. The first cut, you know, I remember we turned in and they were like, well, what's the glue? And then I was like, I actually had never really watched all the footage. And so then we cut a full found footage version. Literally, it was just the found footage. And turned that, and they were like, okay, is there gonna be narration? Like, what's good? I needed to know the backbone though of what the story was. And so we cut that. And then it was spending the next year and a half going in and weaving in the chorus and the interviews. And, you know, and I think also that was part of what the cathartic experience was, is, you know, living with these tapes over and over again until I could, you know, to give that little girl that love of like, everything that's going to happen in your life is going to lead you to where you're meant to be. So that little girl, to leave that letter to her adult self to say, who are you now? Like, have you made your life worthy? Is it full of purpose? And so it was like the coming together of the inner and adult child.
What's fabulous about this is, you know, we're all sitting here thinking, oh my God, where did I put those tapes? I want to go see some of those. Most of them. Fascinating. It's still living on Hulu, correct?
Yes, Hulu, okay. Kid 90, and Punky Brewster is streaming on Peacock right now.
You're everywhere, working. Listen, it's been just an incredible time spending with you, and the story behind Kid 90 is just incredible because it's so relatable to each and every person listening. You see shows on TV that show vintage footage from the early 1900s. Mm-hmm. We're talking about 30 years ago, but that was a world ago for you, and how fabulous, and what a great... another great way to say, hey, write down your memories from your past if you don't have them on video, and rediscover who you are. It can be frightening, but it can be such a payoff. It can be a huge payoff.
And I think you said it so beautifully, and I don't think it's ever too late for us to go on that self-exploration. And to also realize, I think for so long people called it, you know, midlife experience when you're, you know, trying to rediscover yourself. And why not look at it, you know, as really a coming of age again, and how we can look at it as our own personal evolution. And I think a lot of times we can do that through going through the photographs and remembering who we once were.
Wow. Soleil Moon Frye, thank you for being on with us. Of course, she said it herself, but I'll repeat it. Punky Brewster, of course, on Peacock, and Kid 90 on Hulu. And of course, you're always welcome to come back anytime you want. And thank you so much for being here today.
I just want to thank you all so much. It means so much to be with you guys. And please come do a please come join the Punky family. And
do it, Elvis. Do it. Do it. Do it. Do it. Dead body.
I'm going to come die on your show. It's going to be fun. Yes. Everyone will love it. All right, Soleil, have a beautiful day. Thanks for being a part of our show.
Thank you guys so much. I really appreciate it.
The Mercedes AMG Interview Lounge.